Glasses. So for those of you who don't know me, my name's Sister Kathy Duffy, and in the name of the Institute for Religion and Science at Chestnut Hill College, a regional center for exploring science and spirituality, I would like to welcome you to the Sugarloaf campus of Chestnut Hill College, one that's not so easy to find, and to this afternoon's lecture. As some of you know, the Institute aims to promote the constructive engagement of religion and spirituality with science and technology. To encourage dialogue in these areas that is interfaith, multi-science, and civil, we sponsor lectures, a reading circle, and other events and resources. Do check our website for a growing number of videos of our past lectures. We must have about 20 lectures, and it's really a wonderful collection right now. And so I would encourage you to look and watch them, and watch a couple if they're interesting. Continue to watch the whole thing, but the topics are diverse. And we also have a list on the website. We also have a list of relevant books on science and religion. Those books that are housed in our library, Logue Library. And we also have a blog that every once in a while one of us writes something on. And also you can follow us and other proponents of the Science and Religion Dialogue on Twitter. We're really with it. If you haven't signed up at the desk, I think Bridget and Sister Cecilia have been really, capturing you. But if you didn't sign up, if you didn't give in your email, you should do that, because maybe once a month during the academic year, we'll send a list of all of the lectures that we are sponsoring, as far as we know. And, it's good for you to know what's here, and you might be interested in one of them. Next month, for instance, on Sunday, April 17th, Jesuit Tom Reese, the senior analyst for the National Catholic Reporter, will reflect with us on Pope Francis' encyclical, Laudato Si. So that would be a good one to come to. And then during the next academic year, we're going to be focusing on the response of scholars in the field of science, theology, and spirituality to some of the latest developments in neuroscience and artificial intelligence. So, very different theme from this year, but also one that's extremely relevant as the world continues to move in that direction. Nancy Murphy from Fuller Theological Union will be here on September 22nd. That will be our first speaker and the only one that we have finalized, but we have some really good ideas. So today's program focuses on our mission rather than on the content of the science and religion dialogue. Often embedded in ideologies that prevent civil discourse, science and religion are often seen as antagonistic, making civil discourse difficult, if not impossible. Today we hope to learn skills for bridging the tragic gap, as Parker Palmer calls it, and to apply these skills to so many more tragic gaps that we encounter in our world today. The day will flow as follows. Janet will speak with us for a bit, and then she will give us a break, and hopefully. And then what we want you to do is take that time to go next door. There's a reception room next door, and we have some snacks there. And you can take that time to process some of the information that you're receiving. Then after the break, you'll come back here for more, input, discussion, questions, processing. Just so you know the flow of the day. And now I am absolutely delighted to introduce Sister Janet Mock, a person who probably needs no introduction to most of us. Janet is a member of our cousin congregation, the Sisters of St. Joseph of Baden, located near Pittsburgh, as well as a longtime friend of our congregation, the Philadelphia branch of the Sisters of St. Joseph. Many more of us know Janet from her dedicated work with younger members of our congregations as executive director of the Religious Formation Conference, and her amazing work as executive director of the Leadership Conference of Women Religious during those most difficult years of dialogue. Janet is an extraordinarily gifted woman, well known for her challenging questions that cut to the heart of the matter, her warm, discerning, and listening heart, her commitment to the future of religious life and to our younger members, her largeness of vision, and her openness to change. Janet uses these gifts and talents for the life of the world. Janet's leadership in the LCWR, in her congregation during a time of great change, in the Ecumenical Institute on Racism, in the Religious Formation Conference, so many places where conversations have been difficult, makes her eminently qualified to help us with our difficult questions. Questions that concern so many of us in a world that continues to become more global, more diverse, and ever new. How do we manage our response to this changing world? How can we encourage ourselves and others to engage in issues of importance even when we don't see eye to eye? How can we stay at the table even when the conversations are difficult? Janet, we're so happy that you've taken time from your extremely busy schedule to be with us today and to share your experience and your wisdom. And now I ask all of you to join with me in welcoming Sister Janet Mott to Chestnut Hill College.
I think I better leave now. Thanks, Kathy. It's an absolute joy to be here with you. Knowing many of you, I feel very much at home in your midst. And, of course, the Sisters of St. Joseph of Chestnut Hill are very dear to our community because our foundress, Mother Austin Kane, entered here from Evansburg, Pennsylvania. And she went through her novitiate here in her early years. And then she went to Brentwood, helped found Brentwood, New York, and then returned home to Evansburg to make our foundation. So we feel a deep kinship with the Sisters of St. Joseph of Philadelphia. We feel a deep kinship with all Sisters of St. Joseph, but there really is a special bond having gone through a very similar formation. So it's great to be home here. While I'm delighted to be here, the topic is a bit daunting. Change, contemplation, civil discourse. Daunting, but absolutely apropos for our times. And so I'd like to begin by reflecting a little bit on our current context. Biblical scholar Francis Maloney says, "Text without context is pretext." If we don't understand the history and the trends in the world around us, we simply make up a current reality and make up an equally banal interpretation. And there's certainly enough of that going around today. So what in the world is going on? Some of you know Sister Mary Daniel Turner, Notre Dame Dana Muir sister who died about 6 years ago. But she had this cogent response to that question, what in the world is going on? Complex and profound interactions among many forces that are simultaneously yet paradoxically creative and destructive, hope-filled and depressing. So it's an age of great ambiguity. We have great things happening, and we have tragic things happening every day. Robert Schreider, who's a Precious Blood priest, teaches at Catholic Theological Union, suggest three of these profound interactions among the most compelling today. Globalization, an uneasy coexistence among pre-modern, modern, and post-modern thinking in the contemporary world. And third, the interaction of violence and religion in the world today. So I'm going to talk a little bit about each of those as the context. So where are we with globalization? Schreier identifies globalization as shorthand for describing the world order which has been emerging since the end of the political alignment of the Cold War in 1989 and the gradual emergence of new relationships in the world. This phenomenon, as we know, contains forces that are simultaneously, yet paradoxically, creative and destructive, hope-filled and depressing. Globalization, Schreider suggests, is marked by the interconnection of four features of this world. Advances in communications and technology. I was just visiting my niece and her grandchildren knew much more. They're in first, third, and sixth grade. They knew more than any of the adults in the room about this. The dominance of systematic neoliberal capitalism, which by its very nature advances the interests of those who are wealthy and alienates those who are poor. A new alignment in the political order with emerging strength in countries like China and India. And dramatic socio-cultural changes attendant upon changes in communications, economics, and politics. So one of the dominant forces that drives globalization is economics. Consequently, even as these features point to a more interconnected, interdependent world, they're also widening the gap between those who are included in the flow of money and those who have no access to it. So what in the world is going on? We can be proud of international organizations. Right now, there's so much going on globally to educate hotels, airlines about human trafficking. That's one of the wonderful effects of globalization. Doctors Without Borders is another example of medical professionals donating their services across the globe. We're amazed and grateful for companies that have developed computers that can be used by children in the very remote places of the globe. So we continue to be inspired by people, and I think everyone in this room included, who daily hope against hope on behalf of others. And without your assistance, we would all live in greater despair. So globalization is part of the fabric of the third millennium. And the truth is, it means all things to all people, and we need to determine what we mean by it. It can refer to global trade, the World Wide Web, the international currency transactions, and economic depression. It can be exhibited through companies like Starbucks and McDonald's and Disney. Today, the largest economic players in the world, 56 are national governments and 144 are companies like Microsoft, Philips, and Sony. So globalization can also refer to the international movements using its global influence for creative possibilities rather than to sink into selfishness and despair and immobilization because of its power to disenfranchise and impoverish those who have no access to any power. And how are those of us who are Caucasian preparing ourselves as well as those with whom we live and minister to be one among many instead of a dominant culture? because in very short order, right, by 2030, Caucasians will be a minority race in this country. And how are we preparing ourselves for that and preparing those we encounter? So what else is going on? Well, Schreider says this interaction between pre-modernism, modernism, and postmodernism has a great effect. Anybody in this room who is over 70 holds all three of those within you, because many of us were born in a pre-modern mindset, and it manifests itself. They say it's marked by a truth being derived from authority outside ourselves and received by the masses through spiritual intermediaries. So that you don't hold the truth. Somebody else holds the truth, and you're educated to the truth. That doesn't fly anymore, thank God. But it shaped many of our worldviews. And the governance model for that is the feudal system. Everybody knows one's place within the system. If any of you are fans of Downton Abbey, you know everybody knows their place. Yeah. And when Carson and Mrs. Hughes were getting married, and the people upstairs thought it would be just wonderful if they had their wedding upstairs, they were insulted, as they wanted their own wedding in a place where they would be comfortable and have some control. Modernism, which is from maybe the 1500s to the 1900s, it was the age of inquiry and discovery, the age of enlightenment, asking questions and being suspect of authority. You can see why the Catholic Church denounced modernism. It's also the emergence of democracies. And the church condemned it because it relied on scientific proof and its suspicion of religious faith traditions. It began to raise up questions about why people believe what they believe, and that was very threatening to the church. And postmodernism, the 21st centuries in which we live, it's marked by a coexistence of pluralities. There's more than one right answer. You can look at a situation and come at it from different perspectives, and we learn from one another's perspectives. Chaos theory becomes acceptable, not only acceptable, somewhat desirable, as we see that that the creative act really emerges out of chaos. It's a great comfort for us today, because we certainly are experiencing a lot of chaos. And the disestablishment of institutions, the eroding of institutions. I saw a wonderful YouTube on the internet. It's called Metamorphosis. You can just Google it and find it. But they have been able to look through a chrysalis to see what actually happens inside a cocoon during the transformation. It's recent. They've just been able to develop instruments fine enough to do this. But it looks like utter chaos, and they show the inside, you know, in the actual video or DVD. But it's very, very interesting to slowly see the imaginal cells become more dominant. And as they become more dominant, it takes the shape of the butterfly. Now, this is an interesting side note to that. They tested the caterpillars before they went into the chrysalis and found out what kind of food they liked and what kind of food they didn't like. And then they took the butterflies that emerged and tested them and found out they had the same likes and dislikes after going through that metamorphosis. Isn't that amazing? But it all it says is that mess isn't all that bad. That it is the stuff of the creative act. And we are certainly in that right now. Institutions are crumbling. And we look at the presidential race, and all of us are kind of stunned at what is going on and what's going to happen. But it is, credible writers, David Brooks, a staunch Republican, has written some stellar editorials reflecting on this. And one of them was entitled, "I Miss President Obama." Because what he said is that the Obamas brought such dignity and grace and integrity to the White House. And we have long needed that. So it's what is going on. We're experiencing the demise of what was a very staunch political party. And one of the commentators the other day ended his commentary by saying, I'll be viewing Nancy Reagan's funeral today, even as I watch the demise of the Republican Party. But it also is an impulse to do something, to galvanize leadership, no matter what political party you belong to galvanize leadership to say what really is going on, and to think more deeply than the thinking that's being exposed at the debates, because the bad behavior, many in this room are teachers, none of you would tolerate that in a classroom of children. None of you would tolerate that. And so what do we do in a chaotic moment like this? I do want to say that we have in this country, as we have in our religious communities, a body of elders right now. And we have people who hold all those worldviews within them. And I offer that as a gift to society right now. Because while you're here, because you keep reading and you keep learning, you do that through a very solid education and a formation through these years. So all you're hearing that's new comes through that accumulated knowledge. And you, the elders, have the ability to listen to it and sift it and bring a deeper truth and greater wisdom to the conversation. And I really urge you to do that, because that I think that is your call right now, simply because younger people they haven't lived long enough to have, they're living in a postmodern society, so everything's shifting. And a college like Chestnut Hill College is really to be emulated for the wonderful work you do as a liberal arts college to really teach the underpinnings of life through this kind of knowledge and this kind of conversation. It's critically important for our time. But I can't overestimate the importance of the elders in our society who really engage with society, who don't run away from it. Because there are a lot of people who just say, I just want to watch television, let the rest of the world go by, you know. But to really engage the questions of our day and use your life experience to reflect on it and give us deeper insights into what's going on. The third point that Father Schreider raised was the interaction of religion and violence in the world. Fundamentalism is a major threat to the global commonweal, as we see in the effects of actions perpetrated through religious movements all over the globe. The Islamic Jihad, the ongoing conflicts between Palestinians and Jews, and the Christian right in our own country. Some years back, there was an intriguing article in the Washington Post written by a young Jesuit who taught half a year in the Persian Gulf at a new university the Jesuits were opening there. And he taught half a year at Georgetown University. And he was reflecting on teaching the same course named The Problem with God to both audiences. And this is what he says. In teaching a class of mostly Muslim students, Sunnis and Shiites, exploring together with a few Christians some of the basic theological issues, the existence of God, free will, sin, prayer, judgment day, he experienced an intensity and passion that differed in kind, not just degree, from what he experienced teaching in an ordinary class in the United States. For most of these students, religion was something profound, the outward manifestation of an inner relationship with the divine. I want to repeat that last sentence. For most of these mostly Muslim students, religion was something profound, the outward manifestation of an inner relationship with the divine. So in reflecting on this dynamic, because he found just the opposite when he taught at Georgetown. You know, the kids were kind of slouched down, kind of yawning, you know, kind of disinterested. So he was talking about this with one of his Egyptian Muslim friends. And the friend said, yes, talking with Americans about faith and religion is like having coffee with Forrest Gump. It's pleasant enough, but not much substance. They don't have much to say because they just don't get it. Well, what an indictment, really, huh? And how many of us in this room have nieces and nephews, maybe daughters and sons, for whom religion means nothing anymore. And I wonder where they go for meaning, how they get through as they're raising their children, how they get through the tough times. Yeah. So it's a problem. The Jesuit, Father Maher, says that unless he's talking about educating people for diplomatic service, unless foreign diplomats have within themselves an experience of God that shapes their life and actions, they will never understand the people of the Middle East and the problems of the Middle East. His insight, I hope our students carry into their lives a felt-in-the-bone understanding of what it is to live one's life committed to one's faith. And his point is, without this deep relationship with the divine, no amount of knowledge about anthropology or political science will prepare a person for diplomatic service. So unless religion and science are working together, there's no future. And it's a sign of hope, I think, that Secretary of State John Kerry established two offices within the Office of the State Department, one, an Office of Religious and Global Affairs, as well as an Office for Faith-Based Community Initiatives. Those two exist within the State Department. So at least there's conversation going on at that level nationally. So this is just a very brief and minimal overview of what's going on in the world. So what should we do? Mary Catherine Bateson, who is Margaret Mead's daughter and followed in her mother's footsteps, says she's developed a theory that invites an organization to look at its long-held value, the value that is core to its identity, that is indispensable to its future. Bateson goes on to suggest that after you name that value, you project it to its ultimate good. What will it look like if it's the best it can be? And then she invites us to look at it at its minimal level. To name the long-held value at its best. But also, what would it look like if it was completely turned in on itself? I thought about Bateson's work as I pondered and prayed with the title of today's presentation, Change, Contemplation, and Civil Discourse. In many ways, these are long-held values. Because it's an institution, the Sisters of St. Joseph, the call to union with all people, with God, with the universe, that's the long-held value. But in today's society, what does contemplation and civil discourse have to do with furthering union in the world? I recall reading a quote, I didn't read the book. The book is Letters on Modern Atheism by Vladimir Lenin. But here's a quote from his book. We find inspiration in the most surprising of sources. Lenin, at the end of his life, said this, "I made a mistake. Without doubt, an oppressed multitude had to be liberated. But our method only provoked further oppression and atrocious massacres. My living nightmare is to find myself lost in an ocean of red with the blood of innumerable victims. It's too late to alter the past, but what was needed to save Russia were 10 Francis of Assisi's." Amazing, huh? But think about, I mean, just take a moment at your table right now and think about what hadn't you thought about before, or what don't you agree with, or what holds something for you? What holds some energy for you? And why does it hold it? Go deep with it. Just take a few moments in quiet. And then when you're ready, you can go into the next room. And then we'll come back. It's 2:15 right now. Let's come back at 2:30. So 15 minutes from when, whatever your watch says. Okay, could you draw your conversation to a close?
And then there's Andrew.
And I'd like you just to take a moment just to be quiet and think about what you heard from the other people at your table. And if there's any insight that anyone thinks you would want everybody to hear, would you just raise your hand and somebody will bring a mic to you.
were a number of things we came up with. One was, how do you assess the context if you have no knowledge of history? In our society, we find it difficult to sort out our core values. There was a time when this country was white Protestant, when people pretty much agreed on the commandments and a few other things, and they provided a very solid foundation. Today we talk about the Constitution, but we don't agree on what it means, and we don't look at other values that are contained and expressed in our history, and this causes a big problem for us today.
Okay, thank you.
Janet, that was excellent. Thank you.
Thank you.
I just wonder how we became so silent. We were never so silent.
Mm-hmm.
And so satiated. And so okay with everything. And that we don't know how to speak.
Mm.
We don't know how to stand up and take our place. We have great spiritual leadership. Everyone in this room. Don't have to be a religious. It's like, I keep saying, what is wrong with us?
Mm-hmm.
What's wrong with me? And what is wrong with us? And where do we go off track? Because you just take today, we have plenty to say to each other. Mm-hmm. And this is our time. I love that whole piece of the call. But this is our time for spiritual leadership. We all have
mm-hmm.
that. Mm-hmm. Many of us are, you know, cradle Catholics. So what is it that keeps us from standing up in the political culture and milieu in which we live? It's
mm-hmm.
pathetic. And it's Mary Oliver who says, how pathetic when we're cautious, when to go headlong, we could save someone's life, maybe our own.
Mm. Thank you.
I was really struck with the professor who was teaching both the Muslims and the students at Georgetown University. And I think the conversation at our table has deepened for me the idea that as elders, and I'm not one of them yet, but as elders, we do hold so much that we are able to reflect on and be able to bring to all of our world situations in the chaos that it is. And I think that one of the calls that we have as religious, and Janet so did for us today, was to say, go deeper. Be able to take whatever it is and go deeper, even what we were going to be thinking about here today. And then that whole question of that deep core value, what does it look like at its best? What does it look like at its worst? And I think as women religious in particular, and Catholics, Christians, whatever, we really do already have the sense of what that is. But we have such a great number of people, if we were able to do it together more so. I think that would be helpful. Thanks.
I'm going to address this to Janet. And I'm going to say, having been in the leadership position of the National Sisters group, what would you say would be coming from all of those varied congregations across the United States that would say, what could sisters be doing more now on a public stage than they have been doing in the past?
I think all I want to say about that is when we refer to, at LCWR, when the troubles began. As Carol Zinn was among the the troublemakers, yes. What we were totally not expecting was the volume of mail that came to the office of we actually had to hire somebody for a full year to handle the mail from laity, Catholics, people from all kinds of religions. But letter after letter of saying what sisters meant to them in their life. And we were asking the question you're asking, how do we mobilize ourselves? And what we found out is we are mobilized. We are everywhere. And it's in the trenches where the work is done. It's where we are, and it's our ability to bring that word to places of power, whether it's listened to or not. But the voice is there because we're there. We're in both places. And we're Americans, so we want to organize and we want to get something done. And the great learning through this was that we are getting something done. And it was amazing to us that the power of women across the globe working together, and men and women in companionship with sisters across the globe, we are getting something done. So we want to organize, and we want, because that's our natural bent. We want to organize and get, you know, I think the question Lil raised about this moment in American history, what can we do, is really, and it's your question too, what can we do? And I throw it back at you. What are you going to do? So I'd like to move on now. Is there anybody else who had his or her hand up? Okay. I'd like to move on, and then we'll open it up for conversation again. So I want to talk more directly about contemplation and civil dialogue, or civil discourse. I come from Pittsburgh, and Pittsburgh is the city of rivers. If any of you know Pittsburgh, the Monongahela and the Allegheny Rivers flow and form the Ohio River in the city of Pittsburgh. So when they were renovating the downtown area some years back, they were digging, and they wanted to build a fountain there and have the water from the Ohio River, where the convergence happens, be the water for the fountain. And when they dug down, they found a fourth river that flows underneath all the rivers. And when they did research on it, they realized it had been discovered earlier, about 150 years earlier, by a little religious sect called the Harmonists, who settled about 25 miles north of Pittsburgh. But they tapped the water for clearer water, and they were the ones who originally found this fourth river. But when they were digging for water for the fountain, they found this fourth river. They began to do studies on it and found its water from a glacier from 70,000 years ago. It runs beneath all the waters at a steady temperature of 55 degrees all the time. It never varies. It's steady, it flows, it keeps flowing. It's very, very pure water. And when it is tapped, it has enormous energy. It is, if you've ever seen the fountain at the point, it's gorgeous. And it's that water that is the energy coming from that water. I think that's a wonderful image for contemplation, because we have this divine life within us. It runs at a steady pace all the time. It's always there. And when tapped, It has enormous energy, enormous energy. So I'd like to read this. I apologize to anyone here who's not a Christian. I'm going to use Christian language in this, but it's bigger than Christianity. But this excerpt from the Blue Mountains of China, it says, Jesus says that in his society, there's a new way for people to live. You show wisdom by trusting people. You handle leadership by serving. You handle offenders by forgiving. You handle enemies by loving. You handle violence by suffering. In fact, you have a new attitude toward everything, toward everyone, because this is a Jesus society and you repent not by feeling bad, but by thinking differently. I'm going to read that again, but I'd like you to conjure up in your mind the political environment in which we're living right now. And think of these words. You show wisdom by trusting people. You handle leadership by serving. You handle offenders by forgiving. You handle enemies by loving. You handle violence by suffering. You repent not by feeling bad, but by thinking differently. And that's what we need to do today. We need to think differently. And so, what does it mean to develop the depths that we're capable of within us? We have the energy of divine power within us, and it's steady whether we're aware of it or not, whether we draw on it or not. It's there. It's coursing through us, continuing to create us into who we are and who we will become. It's a classic book. It must be about 60 years old now. Johannes Metz, Poverty of Spirit. But there's a passage in there. He says, from the very start, we are something that can be, a being who must win selfhood and decide what to be. We must fully become what we are, a human being. To become human through the exercise of our freedom, that is the law of our being. Now, this freedom which leaves us to ourselves is not pure arbitrariness or unchecked whim. It's not devoid of law and necessity. It reveals itself at work when we accept and approve with all our heart the being that is committed to us. When we make it so much our own, that it seems to have been our idea from the first. Our self-acceptance is the basis of the Christian creed. Assent to God begins in our sincere assent to ourselves. Accepting ourselves. And to the degree that we can accept ourselves, we can accept others. To the degree that we do not accept ourselves, we fight that part of ourselves we have not accepted when we see it in somebody else. It's called projection. So that journey of self-acceptance, which is a lifelong journey. I love that line, you know, to accept yourself so much that it's as if it was your idea to be just as you are. You know, to really accept yourself as you are, that must give God infinite pleasure when people can really do that. And it is a lifelong journey, and I kind of think that's what death is. It's the having grown to that degree of freedom that you, your body just can't contain it anymore. It's just one. It's one with God. Jules Toner, in his book, Discernment of Spirits, says this: to give God intelligent service, to escape the malice and deceptions of the evil one and our own sinfulness, and to open ourselves to the Holy Spirit, to recognize and yield to God's gentle breath, we have to learn as best we can to read our own hearts. And the journey of this fullness of life is really a journey of self-reflection and self-transcendence. And if we go to either extreme, we either get totally absorbed with ourselves or we lose ourselves in taking care of everybody else. But it's the self-knowledge that keeps you steady, self-reflecting, and self-transcending, so that what you're learning from the self-reflection is given as gift to others and given as service to others. Bernard Lee is a Marianist brother who teaches at St. Mary's University in San Antonio. And he's developed what he calls rules for a dialogic community. He wrote four of them, and then Mary Daniel Turner, whom I referred to earlier, added a fifth, and I think it's worth adding that fifth one. But these are the rules. When I speak, my entire reason for speaking is to give another person his or her best chance for understanding me, what I think, how I feel, where I come from, where I'd like to go, what matters to me a lot, my likes, my dislikes. If I ever have the intention, while I'm speaking, of convincing another person to see it my way, I've lost it. I speak not to convince, but to be understood. That's the first rule. Not to advocate, simply to be understood. Secondly, when I listen, my entire reason for listening is to give me the best chance of understanding another person. I must hear them on their grounds and let their words mean what they mean to them, not what I would like them to mean to me. So if I start refuting or arguing when I'm listening to somebody, and especially if the refuting is just internal and I haven't voiced it, I've lost it. You know how sometimes when you're listening, maybe right now, you're listening, and you're saying, I don't agree with that at all. It's simply to listen. And it's to prepare your heart for dialogue. And you can only do that if you really get to know the other. And then third, participants in true dialogic communities each agree with the others to this: I will not walk away from the conversation no matter what. I'm not going to take my dishes and go home. I'm going to stay at the table. And that frees everybody in the dialogue to say what has to be said. We had a sister in our community, a brilliant woman, just a wonderful woman, and in her final years became kind of an icon. She was so surprised because everybody liked her so much because in her early years she was a real firebrand. And she would invariably, chapter after chapter, especially during the big changes, you know, she would, at a very particular moment, say what she had to say and then walk out and not come back. And years later, she said, I was terrified. But she was terrifying. Because she wouldn't stay at the table. She just walked out. But she mellowed beautifully and was greatly revered. So she came full circle. But this, the idea of being willing to stay at the table no matter what, and it doesn't mean that your body stays there, just. It means your heart stays there, your mind stays there. And then the fourth is, he said, if I know something that will strengthen your position against my position, and you do not know it, I must tell you. Because the goal is not to win an argument. The goal is to live together in truth. So if there's something about your position that I have an insight into that would strengthen your position, I have an obligation to tell you. So that we together we seek truth. And then this is what Mary Daniel added. Finally, trust that this argument can be very wholesome. One of the best ways of grounding argument is to ask, what are the consequences for lived experiences of each position, and which consequences better serve the kind of world we would like to make for ourselves and for those who will come after? So, these roles, when I speak, my entire reason for speaking is to be understood. When I listen, my entire reason for listening is to understand you, where you come from, your worldview, what you like, what you don't like. I promise I won't leave the conversation, no matter what. And if I know something about your position and you don't know it, I have an obligation to tell you, because what we're after is truth, not winning. And finally, what kind of a world do we want to leave for those who come after us? So I offer that as, I mean, if we really practice that, and it's hard. It's hard, because all of us have been trained in critical thinking. So almost always, as soon as somebody begins talking, this little machine goes off in our head, you know. And there's time for that. There's time for that kind of intellectual discourse. And critical thinking is terribly, terribly important. But this is building relationships. This is about building relationships, building an atmosphere where there can be real dialogue going on. And that takes time. And it takes getting to know people. So you listen to the other to understand where they're coming from. And you speak so they know where you're coming from. And it slows everything down. Yeah. It was one of the challenges, Carol will can speak to this as well, because people wanted us to make statements to the press in the early days of the conflict with CDF. And there was nothing to say because we were at this stage. We were trying to understand them. I'm not sure they were trying to understand us, but we were trying to understand them. And we were trying to get a foothold in. And Carol and I were both present for this moment when one of the archbishops who works at the Congregation for the Doctrine of the Faith said to us, I've been here 15 years, and what I would say is over the years, there arose a feeling about LCWR that became institutionalized. And that was the truest statement. We felt that was an honest statement. Because at one meeting, they said, well, we're not talking about you. I said, of course you're talking about us. This is the leadership of LCWR. Who are you talking about if you're not talking about us? No, we're... But it was that. Because anybody who didn't fit into this institutionalized vision of what these wild sisters were, they were okay. And isn't that true of sexism racism, any of the isms, there arises a feeling that becomes institutionalized. And it's so difficult to break that. So difficult to break that image. But that was a very helpful moment for us in just understanding. It was painful, but it was helpful to know that that's what was going on. So the staying at the table is really, really, really important. I want to close this section with something from Bernard Loomer, who teaches at the University of Chicago, the Divinity School at the University of Chicago. And he talks about the size of a soul. He's developed a whole theory of power. He does a lot of writing on power. But what you have to understand is when he's using the word power, what it means to him is love. So the use of power is loving another. So out of that framework, he develops this idea of what he calls the size of a soul. And he says, by size, I mean the stature of your soul, the range and depths of your love, your capacity for relationships. I mean the volume of life you can take into your being and still maintain your integrity and your individuality. I mean the intensity and variety of outlook you can entertain in the unity of your being without feeling defenseless and insecure. I mean the strength of your spirit to encourage others to become freer in the development of their diversity and uniqueness. I mean the power to sustain more complex and enriching tensions. I mean the magnanimity of concern to provide the conditions that enable others to increase in stature. And then he says, to me, size is the fundamental category. It's the essential principle. Everything else in life is an abstraction from this and a commentary on it. But that you keep growing, the stature of your soul keeps growing. One of the most vivid examples of this was a Sister of Mercy, Elizabeth Carroll. She was from Pittsburgh. She's Pittsburgh born and raised, and was, when I entered our community, she was both president of Carlow College and she was major superior at the same time. That only lasted a few years. Then they named somebody else president of the college. She was president of LCWR. Margaret Brennan and Mary Daniel Turner told me once in one of their visits to Rome, at that time the Congregation for Religious, the prefect had a file on his desk that thick, and he said it was the file on Elizabeth Carroll. And they said there could have been blank sheets in there because he never opened the file, But he brought it out to intimidate them because she had been president the year before, president of LCWR. And when she was no longer major superior, I think she was 70, she went to Peru. She learned the Spanish at age 70. And she went to Peru to work in a women's shelter there. And when she was 83, she wrote a groundbreaking book on patriarchy, which may say something about that file. But anyway, she wrote this groundbreaking book on patriarchy in Spanish. When she was about 86, she began to get forgetful. And they decided, Sisters of Mercy talked with her, and together they decided she would come back to Pittsburgh. And when I was at the Religious Formation Conference, when I was reading back in our history, I discovered that she was in LCWR at that time and had a lot to do with the beginnings of the RFC. So I went to talk to her. And I knew Elizabeth Carroll from being in Pittsburgh. And when I went in the room, she said, "Oh, now I know who you are." She said, "When they told me your name, it didn't mean anything to me. Now I see your face, I know who you are." She had lost all her long-term memory, but she was so intellectually sharp. We had a wonderful conversation. So I would say, "Do you remember this?" "No, she didn't remember that." "Now, was I involved at the Religious Formation Conference?" "I don't remember that." You know, she couldn't recall anything she had done in the past, but she was wholly present to the present moment. And she said to me, "Janet, everything is a gift. And that gift of memory is gone. But I still have my intellect. I still have my personality. I still have my friends. That's everything." Now there's the stature of a soul. You know, to accept what you have. To accept what you have in the present moment. So, in closing, I want to open this up for conversation, but in closing, I want to just close with this. There's a beautiful excerpt in Chesterton's book on Francis of Assisi. He wrote a lovely small book on Francis of Assisi. But in one of the passages, he says, "For all that Francis gave up, there's one thing he never relinquished, and that was the manners of a court. From the beggar in the forest to the sultan, he treated everybody with respect." And he said, and it says, "For all that he gave up, Francis never relinquished the manners of a court, but in this palace called Earth, there was one courtier moving around 100 kings, for Francis treated everyone like royalty." And that is the secret to discourse, to civility. And you can't make it up. You can't pretend to respect somebody. We know when somebody respects us, and we know when somebody doesn't respect us. There's no words need to be spoken. You just know it. And that was the beautiful thing in Chesterton's reflection on Francis, that he was so in love with Earth and all that was part of Earth, that he treated everything like royalty. So let's kind of open it up for conversation. I think I'm kind of haunted, Lil, by your question about what do we do in this current climate with such a lack of civility? And and part of it is what each of you do on a daily basis where you are to promote it. But how does that galvanize so that as a nation we don't tolerate it?
Just a comment. I think that's a key piece. We can be doing the same things and not recognizing it's a new moment. Mm-hmm. Today's first scripture,
yes.
Isaiah 43,
yes.
It's happening all the time.
Yes.
We're missing it. Perhaps.
Yeah. Yes.
I'll be over there.
I think it's John Ford who says in his book, we need to add that new layer to everything we're about. And when we add that new layer, God can work.
Would you say it in the mic again?
I think it's John Hoyt, his book on infinite. He says, we need to add the new layer. And once we have that new layer, everything changes. And we need to see what's happening, see mm-hmm. what's changing.
Yes.
I totally agree with what has been said. It is a new moment, and it was a beautiful experience to know what happened with LCR leadership and religious and those who have been supportive of that. But it's almost to me like you have to get in trouble before you can get to the table. Mm. And
good point.
What she said. Oh. So what can I and we do to get in trouble?
Work for women's ordination.
Well, part of my concern is the role of women, of course, all women, whether it's ordination, but more importantly, making decisions in the church. And I was sharing at the table something of what Lil expressed. I don't know if you've seen the movie Where to Invade Next with Michael Moore, the activist. Oh. And I was so inspired by that movie. And there's a part, he's invading different countries to see things that can work successfully. And the one that struck me a lot was there was no tuition for the universities in one of the nations that he visited, I forget which one. And they had decided, leadership had decided that, no, we ought to have a little tuition. Let's start some tuition. And when they did that, announced it, the students were in an uproar. They all gathered, they all stood there and had their little sayings and held their banners and leadership decided not to have a tuition. And then he showed an announcement by a university in the United States that was finding out that they were having a raise in their tuition by 8%, whatever the percentage was. And all the students on the campus sat under the tree, went for a walk, did absolutely nothing but accept this is how it is. And it touched me that I feel like them. I feel like those students that hear something and I do nothing because I feel so powerless. And one of the main issues for me in the church is this. I don't want to be a priest, but I want women priests, but I want women, all women, free to be at that table, to be making decisions. So what do we do for the next best step? How do we even initiate that conversation? I'm thinking all the wonderful things that Network does, and it's always about please sign, please sign. I wish there was something that all people in the church could sign about the need for addressing those issues. Where do we go from here? Thank you.
Thanks. Thank you. The thought that comes to my mind when you say we sign, we sign, we sign, we can sign forever and a day and nothing's going to happen, because I look at that piece of paper and put it in the trash. I put it in the drawer at the bottom of the desk. Maybe if people stood up in church and said, don't give money to the church, or something visible, an action, not a signing, but an action of some sort, then they'll take notice. If a lot of people in Philadelphia stopped contributing a couple weeks to the collection, which goes to all these priests and a lot of good men there, but goes to Rome, goes to the Archdiocese, goes here, there, and everywhere. And they have their Rolls Royces and their Cadillacs and their Scotch, and they have good times. There are a lot of good men. I don't mean to take away from that. But it has to be an action. We can sign papers for however many people sign the paper, but where is it going to go?
They go somewhere. Yes, and I think many of us do, and I don't know if you know about Call to Action or the Women's Ordination Conference or Dignity or Catholic Church Reform International. There is a growing movement from the grassroots that needs to be fed with people who feel as you do, who want this kind of change. I mean, if you feel interested, if you're not doing anything on Holy Thursday morning, 11 o'clock in front of the cathedral for women's ordination, try that. See how that feels. You sing songs, you pray, and you join with like-minded people. Come. And if you want information about any of the other groups, I'd be happy to provide it too. Marge, who just spoke, is in with Women Church Convergence, a larger organization of organized women. So there are plenty of venues in addition to the LCWR, which of course has done remarkable work too.
I'm not religious. Okay, I'm a laywoman.
And I bet you are religious.
Yeah. That too. Being involved with all of those organizations and signing for Network and working with, you know, SEPA Walk and Call to Action, all that. As a married woman with children and grandchildren, and listening to your presentation, I was very affirmed in that, even though my kids don't presently are not involved in the institutional church, I find my example of speaking out to them and my example of being involved in some of the organizations that are looking towards the future of the church has had an impact on them. Being involved with lay groups within my community, my neighborhood, and my local parish, and in Chester, speaks to them. Mm-hmm. And I was telling the group here, my kids don't partake in the institutional church, but they are the greatest Christians I have ever seen. And I'm very optimistic about that. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Thank you.
Since you brought up Betty Carroll and a lot of those other names, they were all in Detroit at the first Women's Ordination Conference.
They were.
But Betty Carroll was the keynote speaker, and something she said has guided me every day since 1975, but it could apply to any of us in any work we're doing. She said an embittered female clergy would be an abomination worse than our present situation. Yeah. Amen.
Yeah. That's great. A priest said to me one time, I think what they're really afraid of is the first 500.
Thank you. One of the definitions that the talking about the Muslim students, the fact that they had an inner relationship with this other, we would say God, seems to me that that word relationship and relationality and its presence from the very beginning of the creative process, and it permeates life, and maybe it's that coming to a deeper consciousness about relationality relationships is an opening to the other. And the other can be in any arena of life. Yes. But it's bridging the gap between this side and that, the inner, the outer. We were talking about the divide between, you know, the young people today and our generation, and the divide that's there. And it's easy for us to kind of put the blame on they're not doing or they're not being, or and there's a relationship that's going on, and it's my half that I have to worry about in that relationship.
Thank you. And another Betty Carroll story is when she was older, and Cynthia Sergak, who's the Sister of Mercy, said to her, she was a novice when Betty was Major Superior, and she said, "Betty, what I always appreciated about you is that you would listen to us. You would just let us talk, and you wouldn't say anything, but you would listen to us." And Betty said to her, "If the truth be known, I didn't understand one word you were saying." But she didn't react to it, because she knew they held truth that was going to be important for the future. And what a gift, yeah. What a gift. Well, speaking of gifts, it's been absolutely wonderful being with you. Thank you so much for the privilege of being with you this afternoon. Thank you.
And speaking of gift, I think it's a gift to us, right? To have Janet with us and all of the wonderful things that she's... So we were looking for some guidance about civil discourse, and I think we've gotten some wonderful, wonderful advice. So hopefully we'll begin to do a little bit. Yes, you can say all you want.
All right. Keep processing these things, yeah. But... You know, those of you who feel the urgency, that really feel the urgency, what I would encourage you to do is gather with other people and begin praying about what you should do. Because the action will follow the prayer. But ask for what you need. Ask for what you must do. But do it together. That would be wonderful. It will begin to mobilize.
So thank you so much for coming. Come back again. And I think we all had such a wonderful afternoon. So thank you.